Okay. Welcome to the Newmarket Zoning Board of Adjustment meeting for Monday, December 16th, 2013. And as always, the first order of business is the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. The regular business item on the agenda for this evening is the continuation of a public meeting for consideration of a variance reference section 1.05B1C of the Newmarket zoning ordinance. The applicant, William D. Pothier, requests a variance for a horizontal expansion to allow the existing foundation, flooring, and roof to remain in place. This renovation will involve relocating sections of the existing exterior walls to create alcoves, parens, insets, closed parens, on either side of the building to give the appearance of the separation of the building similar to what existed prior to the reconstruction of the boardhouse and barn, while protecting the structural integrity of the sluiceway and providing adequate site safety. The lot is located at 8 Bay Road, Tax Map U2, Lot 356 in the R2 zone. And I see that we have six folks with us this evening. So, the first thing we need to do before we go further is decide who's going to be voting on this tonight, because there's only going to be five of us. Is there anybody who feels like they're not sufficiently well prepared to go forward and voting on the application tonight? We've had some people drop in and out of meetings, so first I thought I'd throw that open. Does anybody?
I'd rather not vote. You've got five regular members, so that's fine with me, but I'd like to just present my findings.
Okay, Richie.
If I can.
I think what we have under our bylaws is that the alternate can participate in deliberations but does not. Is that correct?
That's right.
Okay. So on that basis, thank you, Richie. And then, so everybody but Richie will be voting on the application tonight. That being said, the evidence was closed, I think, two meetings ago. And we are prepared to go forward with deliberations on the application. So I open the floor to comments or questions. Not comments or questions, but deliberations, thoughts that people may have in relation to the application before us, which has been pending for some time, to be fair. And so hopefully we can get a decision fired up tonight.
Mr. Chairman, we're going to go through the five variances.
We are. We're absolutely going to go through the criteria.
Yeah.
And I think it's helpful to talk about specific, you know, the facts that you base that the findings are based on. So, Richie, if you got something you'd like to put out there for folks to consider.
I can read what I put together, and this is only my opinion. It's not the board's or nothing, and it's just my findings. On number five, the hardship. By its basic purpose, a zoning ordinance imposes some hardship on all property by setting lot size, dimensions, and allowable uses. As we have a unique setting of the property and its environment that had pre-approved plans prior to construction, and that due to the vertical expansion relative to the breezeway and boathouse, an expansion can be accomplished under section 105B if met. I find the proposed variance is one of convenience, not one of necessity. What do we do now? Has prior relief been established on the expanded setback to 6 Bay Road? Does the applicant need a special exception related to the expansion or not? If they are now not needed, my finding on the variance. As we now have unnecessary hardship creating by not building as approved, we must use reasonable use. Being reasonable, in my opinion, would be to leave the roof in place and reduce the expanded breezeway walls back to the width 5 feet as shown on the ground floor plan, referencing the approved building permit that was issued by the town of Newmarket and signed by the code official on 10/15/12. And the variance will not be contrary to the public interest. It will not alter the essential character of the neighborhood or threaten the health, safety, or general welfare of the public. Substantial justice is done by allowing modifications to the expansion as approved, and that the use be consistent with its past use as a boathouse and barn, and relief be granted to convert the use of the expanded boathouse into a private two-car garage. The value of surrounding properties are not diminished. It's a statement of fact that the improvements associated with the sluiceway and increased assessment to the property, the values of surrounding properties will not be diminished. And five, the spirit of the ordinance is observed by allowing the expansion with modification expressly stated that the ordinance did not permit two principal uses on a lot, that this lot has a principal residence use already by virtue of the fact that there is an existing residence on the lot, that while variance relief is supported in connection with rebuilding the structure for an automobile garage and barn use, it is not supported for residential use. That's my five.
Thank you, Richie.
And I think I'd point out it's not supported for commercial use either. The zone is specifically prohibits commercial use, but I mean, we've had discussions about mail order business and things like that being run out of that. I think the that violates the intent of the ordinance if something like that were gone. This is a barn and a garage. That's what should go in there.
Okay.
I think that there's been a substantial amount of evidence presented to support requirements 1 through 4. Number 5, the unnecessary hardship one is, I think, the hardest one for me to get through right now, because there's been so little evidence presented on the use. And, you know, both ways of dealing with criteria number 5 for unnecessary hardship, both key on the fact that the usage is reasonable. And so far, you know, I look through the minutes, I look through everything that's been presented to us, and what we've been told is that it's going to be used for barn and boathouse use with residential use, and then whatever other uses are permitted by the zoning ordinance. So what in my opinion, that's very vague. It's essentially saying that the structure needs to be judged independent of its use, because any use can be used consistent with the zoning ordinance after the fact, which is a true statement once the structure is allowed to exist. However, using that generality to as a basis for unnecessary hardship, I think, is too general.
Hang on a second, Bob. Before I let you speak twice, I want to make sure that Wayne and Elaine have a chance to speak.
Yeah.
Elaine, did you have anything to add?
Yeah, I have two things that bother me. First of all, the word appearance. The appearance of the separation of the buildings. The appearance means it isn't separated the way we told them that it should be. It's a lie, in other words. We're just going to make it look like it. And the other thing is, we told them what had to be done. It didn't get done. And now we're supposed to back off. Where is our credibility if we don't make sure that they do it the way we told them they could do it? They've spent a lot of money trying to get around it instead of fixing it the first time. So I have a problem with that.
Okay. Wayne, before I go back to Bob?
Not at this point.
Okay, Bob?
Let me
just make sure that your microphone is picking you up.
They don't want to hear me. I just keep going back to the reoccurring theme of residential use, mm-hmm. and it strikes me as one of these things where if I say it loud enough and often enough, then it's fact. Mm-hmm. And just because they had maybe a little grill in there and they had a hole in the floor for a toilet, I mean, my kids had a treehouse with a hose to it. They slept in it occasionally. They had water there. Didn't make it residential use. This is a barn and a boathouse. And what we're seeing now is not a barn and a boathouse. And for that reason, I don't think he reaches any kind of hardship potential.
Agreed.
Anybody else? At the moment?
Mine doesn't make that.
Is somebody's cell phone?
Mine doesn't make that quality noise.
If folks can make sure you have your cell phones off or silenced, I'd appreciate it. Obviously, if you have an emergency, then
nobody ever calls me.
That is what it is. I sat down after the evidence was closed and took a look back through, because there's a very significant documentary record that's come into this case between the original application from almost a year ago now, which I wanted to look back at, and what's come in more recently in relationship to the current application. We've had very extensive meeting minutes and a site view. Mm-hmm. So what I did is tried to go back and put all this stuff together for my own purposes to make sure that I covered everything that I thought was significant. So I put together some findings of fact and then the rulings that are very similar to what Richie has suggested. And if I can just go through this,
please.
What I'm going to ask the board to do is just listen, and if you think I'm missing something or I've misstated something, just let me know. This isn't necessarily the final finished product, because we can make a vote and then draft up what the final order is going to be. So I started off trying to give just an overview, kind of this is what the property is and this is where it's at. So the property, and the property is defined as 8 Bay Road, Tax Map U2, Lot 356 in the R2 zone. The property is located within the 100-year floodplain on the north bank of the Lamprey River below the McAllen Dam. The property includes, and that's both prior to the recent renovations and then currently, a residence and a boathouse slash garage structure. Only single-family uses are permitted in the R2 zone under Section 2.10 of the ordinance in the table of permitted uses. There are other uses that aren't pertinent to this application that are also permitted in the R2 zone, but the point is that it's only a single-family use is permitted. The boathouse and barn sat and sit atop a sluiceway that drains stormwater from Bay Road into the Lamprey River, for which the town of Newmarket has an easement. The two buildings were loosely connected by a plank walkway over the sluiceway. The sluiceway was covered, as I understand it, by a separate set of planks. And I think that's something that Richie pointed out to us at one point. The property and the sluiceway experienced significant flood damage in 2006 and 2007. And the Newmarket Fire Department and Public Works Department and numerous volunteers made extended efforts to protect property in that area from floodwaters. So far, sounds pretty good. On April 9th, 2012, the applicant applied for a permit to demolish a boathouse on the property. The boathouse at that time consisted of two separate buildings that shared no common wall. There was a garage structure south of Bay Road and a boathouse or barn, a structure that was south of the garage. The permit, which is 2012-00130, was approved on April 16th, 2012. So far, sound okay? The applicant.
They were not connected, you said, right?
I think they didn't share. They didn't share a common wall, to my understanding, of the photographs and other stuff that we saw.
Okay. All right. Mr. Chairman, I have one possible correction.
Go ahead.
I don't believe the town actually holds an easement. I believe the water has always flowed through there, and there might be some prescriptive rights for the town to
okay.
hold, but it doesn't actually exist as a legal instrument.
Okay.
Okay.
That's good to know. So, but the town has some, at least the argument is that the town has some kind of rights for the water to flow through that property. Okay. I don't think it's particularly material, but that's a helpful correction. Yep, no, that's helpful.
Well, if they had an easement, we probably would be having this discussion because they probably wouldn't allow to build on it.
Okay. The applicant submitted with his building permit application a set of plans prepared by an architect that included foundation, elevation, section, and framing plans. As the architect's plans were not keyed to an existing condition survey, it's impossible to determine definitively whether the proposed structure was confined to the footprint of the pre-existing structures. From the information presented, this is back in October 2012, that appeared to be the intent. Specifically, the ground floor plan, elevations, sections, and roof framing plans reflected that there would be two separate structures sharing no common wall and connected by a narrow enclosed breezeway. In addition, the ground floor and roof framing plans reflected that the garage was to be built at a slight but discernible angle to the boathouse structure, which, based upon photographic evidence, was consistent with the configuration of the pre-existing structures. There's a lot there, but I think that's all.
Correct. Absolutely.
The height of the proposed building was not clearly indicated on the architect's plans. Not to me as an attorney, maybe to you as an engineer, it would have. The ground floor plan reflected a kitchenette and a half bathroom. No full bathroom or bedrooms were identified on the architect's plans. The building permit application includes a question, are you in or out of a special flood hazard area? And the response to that question was no, which I think we need to revise that form. But the boathouse, okay, so far. The structures as built deviated from the plans submitted to the building official in connection with the application. Specifically, this is describing the building as built now. There was no breezeway. The boathouse and garage were directly connected and shared a common wall. The garage was not at an angle to the boathouse as reflected in the plans, and the building was taller than the prior structure. Instead of two loosely connected structures, the applicant built one structure that was both wider in the area where the breezeway was to be located and taller than the prior structures, and the buildings portrayed in the drawings he submitted with his application.
I do think it was built at an angle.
Yes, it was. There's a slight angle.
Yeah, there was a slight angle.
There is a slight angle.
There is a slight angle. Okay. Yes. This is helpful. Other than that, does that all sound...
I think you should point out that there was three separate roof elevations. There was a roof elevation for the barn, a roof elevation for the garage. There was a separate roof elevation for the breezeway in between.
You're referring to the drawings again, ma'am?
That's correct.
Okay. I thought it was super helpful to go back and just look at those drawings real carefully when I was putting this stuff together. So I wanted to make sure that we noted that in our findings. On December 3rd, 2012, in response to complaints by abutters, the Newmarket Code Enforcement Officer, or building official, I use the terms interchangeably, informed the applicant and his contractor that the structure then under construction, and I quote, appears to have been expanded both horizontally and vertically without a special exception granted by the Newmarket Zoning Board and Adjustment, contrary to the Newmarket Code Title III Zoning Ordinance. The building official informed the applicant that the overall size of the building has increased. It appears that the building is taller than the previous buildings and some infill between the two buildings may have occurred, unquote. The building official informed the applicant that all work in the property were suspended until further notice. That's just kind of background.
Correct.
Okay. On January 4th, 2013, the applicant applied for a special exception to allow construction to continue. As part of his application, the applicant made the following statements. When he viewed the property in 2002, it included electrical lighting and power outlets, a point well pump, running water, two stoves, built-in bunk beds, and an old toilet and outhouse that emptied directly into the sluiceway and thence into the Lamprey River. The stoves were apparently used for fish fries that the previous owners hosted on the property in the summer and autumn. The applicant, was told by the prior owner that, quote, in the old days, unquote, her husband and his siblings would often sleep upstairs in the boathouse. Quote, in response to the 2006-2007 floods, the boathouse was raised approximately 5 feet to prevent future flooding with more frequent flooding events and the rising sea levels, although the roof height was well below the maximum allowable height of 35 feet. In order to make the building safer and structurally solid, the boathouse and barn have been rigidly connected as per plans. Previously.
As per which plans?
This is a quote from the application. Okay. So, as per plans, close quote. Then we have a new quote. Previously, the buildings had a loose connection with power and water running between the buildings. However, the sluiceway was completely open and exposed to the possibility of someone falling between the two buildings and into the sluiceway, close quote. He, quote, kept the connector between the two buildings as a separate entity and simply enclosed the open space, close quote. These are all statements made as part of the application. The applicant stated that he planned to make 8 Bay Road his retirement home. The, quote, historical use has been a residence and small business, and structure will continue to be used as a residence and small business, close quote. And then he stated that his proposed use is reasonable because, quote, denial of the variance would not allow the owner to use the property for its intended purpose when it was purchased and for what it has been used to date, close quote. Now I'm moving on to, those are quotes or paraphrases from his application at that time. No plans showing enclosure of the open space adjacent to the breezeway or a common wall between the boathouse and the garage were submitted with the building permit application. That goes back to your as per plans. While the application was pending, the applicant retained counsel, and the application was amended and resubmitted to include requests for 2 variances in addition to the special exception. The variances related to the vertical and horizontal expansion of the property, of the buildings. I think that's about right. Mm-hmm. Just stop me if I'm going off the rails. Following hearings, the variances were granted and the special exception was denied. Special exception for horizontal expansion was denied. I think the special exception for the height was granted and the variances were granted. Right. The records show what they show. The basis of the ZBA's actions appear in the meeting minutes for the meeting of, and I can't remember the date, but they appear in the meeting minutes. And I would briefly summarize what the reasons were, but they are stated in the meeting minutes for those meetings. So that's where things were left back in January, February 2013. On July 10th, 2013, the building official lifted the suspension of the building permit for the limited purpose that the work would be, that work would continue on exterior elements such as doors, windows, siding, site stabilization, and erosion control. The applicant was required to provide within 30 days new plans showing how the building will be modified to bring it into compliance with town regulations. All work was to be completed within 120 days from the date of the building official's letter. And that's pretty closely paraphrasing to what the building official's letter said. On October 7th, 2013, the applicant applied for a variance from section 1.05B1C of the zoning ordinance, which provides, this section specifies those rights to which non-conforming uses, structures, and lots are entitled. Jumping down to paragraph B, the following control non-conforming structures. Paragraph 1, where an existing structure violates the setback requirements, horizontal expansion of the structure within the setback may be allowed if granted a special exception by the ZBA. The ZBA shall grant the special exception only if the following conditions are met. And jumping down to subparagraph C, the owner demonstrates that no other expansion which reasonably fulfills the intended purpose can be achieved in conformance with this ordinance. So the variance before us relates to the specific provision of the ordinance upon which the special exception was denied in the first application. The applicant submitted that the current application is not barred by Fisher versus City of Dover, 120 New Hampshire, 187 from 1980. The details of the application and the attachments submitted therewith are in the record, and I'm not going to repeat them all here. But the applicant states that the more limited horizontal expansion currently sought is intended to maintain protection of the sluiceway and forestall potential health and safety hazard caused by permitting the sluiceway to remain open while maintaining a visible separation between the garage and the boathouse. That's part of what's in the application as I read it. The ZBA has taken written evidence from abutters and the applicant, has had public hearings over the course of 2 meetings. Everyone who wished to comment was given an opportunity to do so during the public hearings. The applicant was afforded an opportunity to present his case in chief, review the written material submitted by the abutters, and to respond to issues and concerns raised by the abutters during the public hearings. We held a site walk. I don't remember the date, but it was in November, Saturday. That was attended by the applicant, his attorney, and several abutters, as well as most or all the members of the ZBA. I had to leave early, but I was there for 15 to 20 minutes.
I was not there.
Bill was not there. Thank you.
I came late, but I did get all, went through the whole thing.
Okay. And but you've seen the property, Bill, and you've had
the property.
You've had a look at it. Okay. So based upon the written material submitted, now jumping down to what I propose to be the rulings, which are very similar to what Richie has suggested. Based upon the written material submitted, the testimony and evidence offered by the applicant and the abutters, the view taken by the ZBA, and other familiarity with the property, the ordinance and the personal knowledge and experience of the ZBA members with the subject property, the ZBA proposes to rule as follows. Number one, the application is not barred by Fisher versus Dover, as the applicant has submitted no prior application for a variance under section 1.05B1C of the zoning ordinance. Number two, this is where we definitely all have to weigh in. The variance will not be contrary to the public interest, as it will not alter the essential character of the neighborhood or threaten the health, safety, or general welfare of the public. As I read these things, I think it's important to bear in mind what I see as the essential scope of the application currently before us, which is essentially to cover the sluiceway while maintaining the separation that we've talked about. It's not exactly, but let me carry on. The spirit of the ordinance is observed by allowing the expansion for the sole purpose of safely covering the sluiceway. The spirit of the ordinance would be violated, however, if the applicant was permitted to make use of the garage and boathouse inconsistent with its prior use. Substantial justice is done by allowing horizontal expansion for the sole purpose of safely covering the sluiceway. The proposed expansion.
When you say that, do you mean the floor and the roof?
I'm talking, as I understand the application before us, it's really to cover the floor. But the roof, whether it's the roof with the insets, I'm not really there. But we can we come back to this?
Yeah, okay.
The proposed expansion would have no adverse impact on the value of surrounding properties. The proposed horizontal expansion for the purpose of covering the sluiceway is a reasonable use. In light of the fact that there is already a principal residential use of the property, however, residential use of the boathouse and or garage would be unreasonable and inconsistent with the letter and spirit of the zoning ordinance. Accordingly, the ZBA rules that the variance is approved, subject to the condition that no residential use shall be made of the garage and or boathouse structures, and the applicant shall comply with the zoning ordinance and building code as directed by the court enforcement officer and provided in the building code and the zoning ordinances. Now, you raised the question about the roof and the floor.
Right. When we talk about that, are we talking about the floor protecting the sluiceway by people falling in through a floor that is non-existent only, or are we talking about the roof as well?
Certainly the floor.
And moving it back to the.
What do you think?
Original plan.
Tell me what you think we should be done.
Okay. I think I would propose that he adheres to the building permit that he obtained in October of 2012, with the exception of, and that by that I mean moving it back to the 4x5, 5x5, whatever passageway through there, not the 5x14 that he proposes. Installing a floor to protect safety for the sluiceway and retaining the roof line as it is.
What do people think of that?
We're definitely going to get some flack on that from abutters, but I think that it serves
one other thing. And no residential use in the future.
Now, but I think it serves the intent. Obviously, creating the box culvert. I'm not going to call it a sluiceway. I'm going to call it a box culvert.
That's what it is.
Because that's what it is. Mm-hmm. I've always maintained that was a separate something separate from the actual building. The building happens to be on the box culvert. And I think we can get that building back into the original plan. I'm happy with it. The vertical expansion was necessary because in order to make use of it, we had to get it out of the floodplain. So whatever we did raised it up. No heartburn with that at all. But there was a plan in place that had a footprint that at least made an attempt at mimicking the what was originally there.
Yeah.
What we've got there now is not that. The roof line, to keep the water off of that, makes sense to me. I've got no major heartburn with that. It does change the look of the property slightly, but I think we could live with that. But it clearly defines that we've got two separate buildings.
Certainly the revised plan that we saw looks an awful lot like a house.
Yes.
And that's concerning. Elaine?
I totally agree. We gave him what had to be done, and we have to stick pretty much to that, I think. Because if we don't, then what authority do we have?
It's a fair compromise and consistent to not make him tear off the roof. And
correct.
Which is basically what you're suggesting.
Great.
As long as he restores substantially the visible separation, the visual separation, and keeps it safe.
Yes. I agree with that 100%.
Mm-hmm. Bill?
Everybody might not, but I do.
Now,
hang on a second, Bob.
I guess I don't think there's a strong connection between what type of horizontal expansion it is, whether it's an open area that's enclosed by a roof of the floor system or it's the outside walls of the structure. I think I'm okay with either of those proposals. I do want to comment on one thing that you said before, which I think addresses my immediate concern, which is that there wasn't really a use specified. So I like the idea of specifying the use through restriction and then using that as the basis to create an unnecessary hardship. I think that's what I got out of what you said. Mm. So correct me if I'm wrong.
Are you agreeing that this is a pretty good approach?
Yes.
Or?
Yeah.
Bill, I would just, I, in other words, you don't care if it's 5 feet wide or 14 feet wide, that area. Original plan versus this plan that we have, that they wanted to go to like 14 or 15 feet wide. Is that what you're saying?
No, I think you know, by virtue of the way the property is constructed now, the horizontal expansion is essentially the same. It's to the roof line, right?
Well, no. I guess my argument would be that.
What you would have alcoves, but they'd be covered by a roof.
Right, but also that five, and I'm using
or
this
passageway. That was a good term.
The passageway. When I went on the site walk, I saw not a passageway. I saw a room in between those two buildings.
It's a common wall.
Right. Yes, I saw a room, and that was not what was on the original plan. So I guess I appreciate your opinion that it doesn't matter either way, but that's what I saw. I saw a passageway on the application in October, and now I see a room in between.
Right, okay, I see what you're saying.
But that's what I'm saying.
I think what Wayne has proposed is very reasonable and consistent with the evidence and consistent with this apparent intention and what the ordinance requires us to find.
Now, just to clarify something, the way I read this, if he wanted to use the area as a home office, that would be an acceptable use for this space?
I think what would be permitted is anything that's currently permitted for accessory structures.
Okay.
As we sit here today.
Yes.
We're making no opinion on use beyond.
But, yeah, commercial use, I mean, we can't open up an office there for.
It's not a permitted use, and the permitted uses in the R2 zone is Irie.
It isn't permitted because it's not in the primary structure. If it was in the primary structure, he could have an office. Because it's in an accessory building, he can't, and that's under the terms of the current zoning ordinance.
That's what I was trying to drive at. Maybe I didn't do it specifically enough in terms of you have to comply with the zoning ordinance in every other respect.
Correct.
No more, no less than what the current ordinance provides in terms of uses, mm-hmm. but there would be no residential use allowed in that structure.
As long
because there's already a primary residence on the property.
Correct.
Yep. On the lot.
So in order to change that destruction or demolition of the existing residence would permit residential use in the structure.
Or a change in the ordinance.
Or another variance.
Another variance.
Right.
Yeah, a new application for a variance, demolition of the, or yeah. abandonment of the existing residential structure, or rezoning.
Or if you wanted to use that as a residence, destroy the
yeah.
old building, you'd have to come in for variance on setbacks. You have to, it's quite a process, I believe.
We're not slamming the door on that.
That's
we're
right.
just saying, as things stand today, on the evidence that we have, and the zoning orders as it exists, this yeah. is the ruling.
Yep. Yeah.
Other options that are available, that's what he has an attorney for, to give him advice on what to do going forward.
So we're talking about, to be specific, we're going to ask for the, or we're going to perhaps vote based on the original drawing for the floor plan, allowing the roof line to remain intact, and to specifically restrict residential use.
Yes.
Bar residential yes. use.
Right. Unless it becomes compliant with the ordinance.
Our ruling is going to be that it's prohibited. If something happens in the future that makes that a substantial change outside the scope of what we're ruling today, that's available if some significant change in circumstance or the law. Okay. You know what I mean?
Right.
Was it likely that happening? I don't know. We're ruling on the evidence and what we have in front of us and the way the ordinance stands today. But I think you're correct, and I think that's consistent with what Wayne has said in terms of what that would be.
And it really addresses the concerns I had that this never had a residential component to it at all, in my opinion. And this just basically casts it in the letter of the law.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we can incorporate into the final ruling the plan that Wayne is referring to, the document that you're referring to, just consistent with the, which plan is it?
This is the original.
You're referring to the
October of 2012.
And you're pointing to, so the record can reflect it, you're pointing to specifically the ground floor plan as submitted with the original application back in October 2000.
Shows the approximate correct. 5 That's foot by 5 foot breezeway.
The approved plan by
this is what he's
as approved by the building official at
that
time.
This is what he's proposing, and this is what we saw
right.
when we went on our
sidewalk. And when you say this, you're referring to the drawing, just so the record can reflect it, Wayne. It's part of the application.
Must have a date here somewhere.
7 September 2013. It's the first floor plan submitted by the architect. Just so the record can reflect what it is. When you say this,
okay, I understand.
The transcriptionist can't tell what you're referring to.
7 September 13.
So Dane should probably make a note of what Wayne is referring to.
Let me just get the date off here. It's the same one I believe we have in the file.
Original and.
October 8th, 2012.
And that's sheet A2.
Mm-hmm.
Sheet A2.
Yep, I got it.
Chris, I know we've closed public comment, but is it appropriate or possible to perhaps ask the applicant's representation to comment on whether this approach is acceptable or?
Nope.
No, okay.
I don't plan to reopen the public hearing in any way at this point. And the applicant has an opportunity to file a motion for rehearing and tell us all the ways in which we're getting this wrong, if they choose to do so.
Which I'm certain that I'm certain that both sides of this are looking at us as wrong, so.
Well, we haven't noticed this for a public hearing, and so I don't think it'd be fair or appropriate for us to do that. Is there anything else? Sorry, Wayne, go ahead.
No, but Bob, I agree. I agree 100%, but I think we've tried to we've listened to abutters, we have listened to the applicant, and I think we've tried to do a reasonable.
To Mr. Pothier's credit, he took something that was one step away from falling into the river, and he created something that's an asset to the town. The way he went about it might have been a little bit wrong.
Or a lot wrong.
A lot wrong. And the abutters that have been complaining, I mean, I would much rather look out at what's there now than what was there before, you know, well, unless I was an odds maker trying to figure out what data was going to fall into the brook. But, I mean, what's there is significantly better than what was there before.
To be fair, when you go back and you look at the applicant, the abutter concerns, which we really appreciate getting, they really boil down to the failure to observe the plan as submitted and the use. So I think we've reasonably addressed. I think we've done our best with the evidence that we have and the law as it stands.
I think so too.
And then somebody who has more authority than us can decide whether or not what we're doing is correct or not correct. But I think we've done our best. Mm-hmm. We've put a lot of time into this application. So, is there, taking into account the corrections that have been made, the comments and things that Wayne has shared about how the plans that we've referenced, is there anything else significant that should be added or noted as part of the final decision?
And I just, one more, I guess, procedurally driven thing. So right now, the applicant's asked for an exception, I'm sorry, a variance to 1.05B1C, and we've discussed previously that granting a variance to 1.05B1C is essentially the same thing as granting a variance for 1.05B1 in its entirety, so that
I think we've already done that as in the prior.
We've discussed that, and that's on the record, right? So
yeah, the rulings that were made back in February or January, that's still, those rulings are still there.
Okay, so I just want to make it clear that voting on 105B1C is the only action needed to relieve the applicant of the requirements of all of Section B1, essentially.
Well, that's the only thing that's been asked for. That's the only thing before us.
Right.
So that's what we're ruling on. I don't think there's anything else pending. And I don't think it's our place to figure out whether there's anything else he needs to apply for.
Right, right. But it's the only thing that needs to be done.
Yep.
No.
From our perspective right now.
Just before we vote here, procedurally, where do we go from here? We take a vote on this, and if we vote to grant the variance, what do we have to do to put together the finding of facts or if we...
I think I take what I've done here. Send it to Diane, mm-hmm. and say, fill in the blanks and draft up something that is consistent with the actual decision that we make.
And it will be recorded in the minutes.
And it will be recorded in the minutes. Okay. And
that will become
it'll be unusual
record.
For us, but we'll have an actual written decision as opposed to just meeting minutes.
Because if we vote in favor of what we have, we're voting on current, and I go back to the plans again, current plan, correct? Without our adjustments. Is that?
No, you're voting with some conditions.
Conditions, I'm sorry,
condition
okay.
The condition is that
okay.
They go back to the original plan showing the 4x5 breezeway.
Right, mm-hmm. or whatever was on the plan, right? Mm-hmm.
Floor plan.
Yeah, original.
Sheet A2.
Sheet A2 dated October 8th, 2012.
Yeah. Okay.
Which doesn't apply to the roof line, right? Still allowing.
I think the understanding is that it would include retaining the roof line that exists,
right.
And installing a floor as appropriate to make that happen.
Stop people from falling into the sluiceway. Yeah,
well, the floor is already there. Those are concrete planks under there, so
right.
It's already there. It's not going anywhere.
I think you still need an, I think you still need a variance for it because it's still, I think, technically a horizontal expansion.
Well, that's why, in my mind, I was separating that from, I was saying that was a box culvert. That was necessary to keep the stream channel there. So I can separate that in my mind, but that's neither here nor there. That what we're doing is, I'm fine with what we're doing.
So I think what I'm going to do is propose that someone make a motion to approve the variance subject to condition of no residential use made of the garage and or boathouse structures. The applicant to comply with the zoning ordinance and building code in all other respects. Compliance with drawing number A2 from the application. The drawing is dated October 8th, 2012. Am I missing anything at all?
No.
I want to, don't you think that all the criteria should be written up before you make a final vote? I think for what we've discussed now, you've pretty much approved the changes, like Wayne had said. But now there's got to be a separate vote on all five criterias.
Okay, we can do that.
I think if you're going to have somebody draw them up, then at the next meeting is when you vote yea or nay. So separately on all five of them.
I disagree. I think we can do one vote.
I think we've articulated.
You've articulated in the record.
Yeah,
I think if you read what they recommend, you vote separate each one separately. Because if one fails, they all fail.
True.
So you have to. They don't recommend you punching all the five criterias under one vote.
Well, that's.
But hey, that, I'm not voting, so
no,
you can do what you want.
That's not what I get from the seminar we went to, where they said you could end up with, if you voted on each one of the five criteria separately, you could have 3-2 on one way, 3-2 on the next, the other way, and you could go down through, and in essence, it...
Why don't we do this? Problems. I'm going to go back and read the rulings on each piece of their criteria.
Mm-hmm.
I will then restate the motion that I'm suggesting that we make. And I think as long as it's clear what the findings are on each piece of their criteria, I don't think it's necessary to vote on each one, unless somebody strongly disagrees.
I don't think, no, I don't see it as necessary to vote on each one.
I think that's the right approach.
Good, because then we can blame it on Diane when it all goes horribly wrong.
Blame it on the attorney. Yeah, sure. They told me it's okay to do it that way.
Which one do you want?
The one that we're going to use in the...
That's the original.
Excellent. Yeah. And Bill, you're looking at drawing A2 by the architect dated October 8th.
That's correct. Okay. I'm just trying to put together some thoughts to articulate a...
Okay. So I'm going to go back over the rulings, and these are the rulings upon which we're asking. The ruling, the motion is going to be based. Everybody ready to hear it?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, I think it's important to say, although it's not under the five criteria, that the application is not barred by Fisher versus Dover. As the applicant has submitted no prior application for a variance under section 1.05(b)(1)(c) of the zoning ordinance. I think we just need to put that on the record. Next is the variance will not be contrary to the public interest, as it will not alter the essential character of the neighborhood or threaten the health, safety, or general welfare of the public.
Correct.
So far?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
The spirit of the ordinance, seeing no dissent, the spirit of the ordinance is observed by allowing the expansion for the sole purpose of safely covering the sluiceway. The spirit of the ordinance would be violated, however, if the applicant was permitted to make use of the garage and boathouse inconsistent with its prior use. Okay?
Yep.
Substantial justice is done by allowing horizontal expansion for the purpose of safely covering the sluiceway or the box culvert.
Correct.
We use those terms interchangeably for purposes of this. The proposed expansion would have no adverse impact on the value of surrounding properties. The proposed horizontal expansion for the sole purpose of covering the sluiceway is a reasonable use. In light of the fact that there is already a principal residential use in the property, however, residential use of the boathouse and/or garage would be unreasonable and inconsistent with the letter and spirit of the zoning ordinance. accordingly. What I'm proposing that someone float as a motion based upon those findings and rulings is that the ZBA approve the variance subject to the condition that no residential use shall be made of the garage and/or boathouse structures. The applicant shall comply with the zoning ordinance and building code in all other respects. And the building will be altered with the exception of alterations to the roof line consistent with drawing number A2, dated October 8th, 2012. That was part of the original application.
So moved.
Second that.
I have Elaine down as, I think Elaine got in the first second.
Get in first.
So the record will reflect that Elaine had the second. Is there further discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. You can have this, and I will email the Word version of that to you tomorrow.
Okay. Did you do good, or?
Is there any? Don't ask him. Don't ask him.
Don't ask him. Ask us. Yeah, you did great, Bob.
Is there any new or old business to come before the board at this time?
I have none.
Entertain a motion to adjourn.
I can make a motion to adjourn.
And I second.
Wayne seconds that. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Thank you. Don't ask Scott Hogan if we did the right thing. The answer is always going to be no.
I think we're done up here.
It's his job.
Good job.
Thank you.